Good morning. My name is Emily Kane. I lead the public health group at USP, and of course, PQM is our flagship program, and we're so proud to be here today and to reach this moment. So I won't do too much introduction. I'll try to make up for some lost time. But I'm pleased to be moderating this first panel of the day, which will be focusing on PQM's work in increasing the supply of quality assured medicines. And as Jude already highlighted, there's a lot of work still to be done. 2 billion patients around the world lack access to essential medicines. In particular, the supply of quality assured medicines needed to treat life-threatening conditions like tuberculosis, malaria, neglected tropical diseases, and advanced maternal and newborn child health can be at risk. In many cases, there may be as few as one manufacturer of an active pharmaceutical ingredient that is quality assured around the world. This results in unfavorable market dynamics and great risk to supply interruptions and shortages. PQM has worked with hundreds of manufacturers around the world to advance them towards international quality standards. Additionally, as Jude also mentioned, and we're so proud, we have helped achieve more than 35 stringent regulatory approvals, WHO pre-qualifications for APIs, and finished products essential to treating life-threatening conditions and advancing maternal child health. So without really further ado, I'm gonna introduce our panel. The way the format is going to work is we'll have about 45 minutes. We'll start with some Q&A that I'll facilitate, and then I'd like the audience to please be ready to ask questions and provide comments in the final 15 minutes of the discussion. So I'd like our panelists to come forward, and I'll introduce you as you come forward. So Penny Smith, USAID's Neglected Tropical Disease Advisor from the Office of Infectious Diseases. Deuce Mubangizi, Coordinator for the World Health Organization Pre-Qualification Team. Irvin Molana, who's Manufacturing System Development Manager for Indonesia's Kalbe Pharmaceuticals, and Lawrence Evans, PQM's Director of Core and Country Programs. Welcome our distinguished panelists. Can everyone hear me? Yes, okay. All right. Well, let's dig right in and welcome once again to our panelists. And I'll start, if you don't mind, Penny, with you at the end. In your experience as an NTD advisor, can you speak to some of the main challenges that your portfolio faced with increasing the supply of NTDs? And also speak to how PQM contributed to progress to date.
Little switch.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Thank you. Definitely not increasing the supply of NTDs. There are plenty of them
Did
out
I
there.
Say an, oh my goodness. Too many.
too many right now. Thank you. But the NTD drugs, yeah. First, just let me give a little context. For neglected tropical diseases, the whole program at USAID and honestly globally exists because of a gigantic global donation program through pharma. Just in the life of USAID, we started in 2006, over $22 billion worth of donated drugs have come through programs that we've supported for NTDs. So we're extremely grateful for that. However, it's not without its restrictions and gaps. So one of the challenges has been restrictions on target audiences. Several of the drugs can only be distributed to school-age children, so between 5 and 14, leaving out preschool-age children and high-risk adults. And then another big challenge, particularly with Merck Germany, manufactures praziquantel, is the limited supply they've been able to produce directly as a result of not being able to source high-quality API for praziquantel. And I'm going to give some great credit to PQM for helping to solve that problem. USAID and DFID alone were buying over 180 million tablets a year of praziquantel to help fill the gap. But we didn't really know what we were buying. USAID was buying through our approved wholesalers, but even then, there's still a big question mark because none were pre-qualified and they we had to trust that they went through some quality assurance standards, but we didn't actually know. So part of why we invested in the PQM project was to help ourselves buy a better quality product. DFID was very interested in that, and then also to help the global market too, but it was somewhat self-serving, at least at the beginning. NTD drugs are very low profit margin drugs, so there wasn't a huge incentive. And where there were manufacturers already manufacturing for local markets, they had buyers without requiring pre-qualification or higher quality assurance standards. And then lastly, just the WHO pre-qualification process was kind of an unknown. What the process was, what the benefits of it were, they were fairly unknown. So there had to be some advocacy involved initially. Those are some of the key challenges.
Thanks very much, Penny. Maybe we'll turn to Irvin. First, let me congratulate you on Calbe Pharma's recent pre-qualification for levofloxacin.
Yeah, thank you very
much. Wonderful accomplishment.
Thank you.
And then let me ask you, so Penny pointed to some challenges sourcing manufacturers to produce some of these lower margin or perhaps less attractive products. Can you speak to what convinced Calbe Pharma to work with PQM in this area?
Okay, thank you for the question. Actually, we feel that the PQM request for us is a good chance for us to improve our people competency and also our quality assurance system to fit with the international standard. So we can supply the high quality medicine not only for our market, because we are the best, the biggest pharmaceutical company in Southeast Asia. And this is also in line with our mission in Calbe, because we have a mission to improve health for a better life. I think it's.
And Irvin, just as a follow-up, can you speak to some of the impact of the technical assistance that you received from PQM? How did it sort of more broadly impact on your organization?
I think the technical assistance given by the PQM is very give big impact for us. They give us a hands-on training and also the GMP audit in every aspect, and also the technical assistance during the dossier development and also during the dossier evaluation and also during the CAPA. And the PQM also join us in our regular meeting to discuss about the WHO requirement and also facing and solve the every obstacle during the project, especially for the Bu Butet, the Indonesia representative for the PQM. And I think this had not been success without the USP and also the USAID support through PQM program. And for that all effort and support, actually, I've already made a 3 minutes video, short video. Maybe if you don't mind, I can play the video. It's okay? I already copied to the... I already summarized all the support. Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, please enjoy the video. It's made by our team. So it's a long journey because we start the commitment letter on 2014. The first USB PQM mock audit and all the training. The second PQM mock audit. And we establish the team. A GLP practice training from root and data integrity and GWP training. We have many training from the PQM. And also to share technical assistance. This is the final USB PQM mock audit with the David Buckley. Yes, behind the scene actually. Are we prepared for the audit? This is the WHO inspection on May last year. is made by our millennial team. So that's why I use Google. Yay! 22nd February. Thank you very much.
Wonderful.
Thank you very much. Yeah, in Kobe we have greetings. Yeah, we have a greetings when we said Kobe. All the member we said
Kobe.
Pasti kelas dunia.
Pasti kelas dunia.
It means indeed
pasti
we will achieve the world class.
Pasti yeah. Kelas dunia. Pasti kelas dunia.
This is our management team. This is our manager team.
Pasti kelas dunia. Pasti kelas dunia.
Yeah.
Pasti kelas dunia.
Yeah, thank you. So the PQM program is give us very big impact because we succeed to change our mindset from the local mindset into the global. Thank you very much for the support.
Wonderful. Well, Irvin, that's going to be hard to beat. And a nice surprise. So thank you very much. I think that gave us a really good sense of what your organization went through and the benefits. So
yeah, you're
thank
welcome.
You. And now let's transition. Sitting next to you, you have the leader of the World Health Organization's pre-qualification team. And you know, Deuce, I'd like to know sort of from your perspective, can you give us a sense of some of the goals of the pre-qualification program and how PQM has kind of worked to help advance those and how we work together?
Yeah, first of all, I'm glad to be here and to listen to the speeches that were made right away from the beginning and the climax that we've just had here. You know,
thank you.
That is what we are here for. We want to see, not to sit here on the panel here, but to see impact on the ground. Yes. Now just to see. Why did pre-qualification begin? It all, there's a long history, I'll not bore you with that. But for those of you who know the world politics or the world programs, in 2000, the world set itself goals, 8 goals, Millennium Development Goals. And this is committed all the then 192 member states to improve access to improve health. And to do that was to expand, one of the things was expand treatment. But there was another reality that Jude referred to. With the WHO regulatory system strengthening, when they looked at the now 194 member states, only 26% of the member states had what was considered a regulatory system that could assure the quality of medical products that are used by member states. Now, how do you achieve the Millennium Development Goals when there is not a system to assure member states of the quality of the medicines? That's what we came into to address. And you know that at the same time with globalization, we are moving from a point where manufacturing was only happening in particular hubs where maybe had the regulatory systems to all over the world, local and international, and products moving globally without these requisite control systems. So that's the background that brought in pre-qualification. Pre-qualification was to assure the quality of medical products that were used in these global programs and used by member states. And to do that, we quickly discovered that in order to do that, you actually do not only wait for the dossier to come to you and you move to inspect a site like that one. Otherwise, you can actually fulfill an exercise and bring a dossier and say non-compliant. Go to a manufacturing site that says non-compliant. And but that was not the objective. You remember our objective was access. So we quickly started, actually long before the PQM in 2004, and I'm going to use one example, to try and see how can we help manufacturers achieve these national, international standards. And the first challenge was I would use a TB one, where at that time, 2004, there was only one supplier of isoniazid API in the whole world. And that supplier, we inspected them jointly with EDQM and was non-GMP compliant. For those who know TB, how do you treat TB without isoniazid? And how do you continue to work to treat TB with a non-GMP compliant source of API? The long story, you have heard the numbers, 35. And that is how we have worked with USP to assure, to reach countries with quite assured medicines. You know, it's not only getting those products on the list and getting there, how do you monitor the quality of medicines as they are being distributed through the sea from Pakistan, India, China, and they reach the, they have not been affected. The countries must have the capacity to assess those products and inform themselves that indeed. And then that's when we expanded with PQM, not only to work with the manufacturers, but to work with the quality control laboratories as a tool. So just to say that we would not have reached the figures and the milestones that we are talking about if we did not have the PQM collaborating with us to support manufacturers, PQM collaborating with us to support countries and national regulatory systems, and training manufacturers. I remember 2014, I spent in Ukraine and Russia with PQM organizing a workshop for 2 weeks to try and mobilize TB manufacturers. So PQM has been behind all these milestones. And that's why actually I'm here, to try and demonstrate. If I cannot say anything with my words, that's why I am here. Because you know we are going through a transformation at WHO. I flew in yesterday, and I'm flying back as soon as we finish here. But I said I must be here to demonstrate that gratitude, to see where the milestone that we have reached today.
Thank you. Thank you. That was a really excellent overview and endorsement. Thank you, Deuce. And now to you, Lawrence, last but not at all least. 10 years of PQM experiences. What have you learned from supporting manufacturers over that time span, and kind of what's next? That's a lot. That's a big question. So maybe just a few key takeaways.
Exactly. I think there's 2 points here. You know, what we've learned and what's next. So maybe we can just put it in those two buckets. You know, one of the things I can say that we've learned is, you know, when we think about PQM, we always think about technical assistance. But I want to just step away from the technical assistance aspect for just a moment. Because one of the things we want to do is actually build sustainable systems. And sustainability is one of the key things. So one of the things that we learned over those 10 years is that, you know, we initially went in with a lens of just looking at the technical aspects of manufacturers when we were supporting them. What we didn't really do initially was really look at the business aspect of those manufacturers when we're doing our risk assessments to determine the viability of those manufacturers. So I think one thing that we changed is started looking at that aspect even more closely, in particular with the chlorhexidine manufacturers. Because, you know, we can put all this technical assistance and all this work into these manufacturers, but it don't have the other aspects of it to sustain it, then everything we've done actually would then, you know, go for naught. So that's one of the key things, you know, and I want to just step away from that technical assistance part because it's bigger than that in terms of, you know, from what we see in terms of the try to support you need from manufacturers. Now I want to get to the other point that you raised in terms of, you know, what's next. There's so many different things, and I can just name maybe a couple of bullet points. And especially in low and middle, one thing, especially in low and middle countries, I see that there's a security issue, so to speak, and it's in terms of active pharmaceutical ingredients. APIs are not produced in low and middle income countries. And this is one of the key challenges we have because the access to by local manufacturers, especially we want to nurture and build those manufacturing on the product side, We need to make sure that they have a good supply of quality assured APIs. So in terms of, you know, there's two ways to do that. One, which is the longer term one, is to try to build a capacity within countries, which is a very long term, you know, goal or objective if we go that path. But then there's the other one, is making sure that there's the pathways to making sure that those API suppliers are then getting those APIs to those, to the manufacturers and LMICs. That was the one part I wanted to bring. Then the last part I just want to mention, and this is something I look at, it's called like these pharma ecosystems. So I think most of us know what like an ecosystem is in terms of like the environmental ecosystems. Everything has a play. So this pharma ecosystem, I kind of like think of it as, you know, everything that goes into making sure that we have good quality products. But one of the things that we've really haven't taken a look at is those supportive systems that goes into maintaining that ecosystem, especially in low and middle income countries. So we talk about those auxiliary services, like for example, a calibration company that Calbee may need, or that CRO, or you know, the educational side, which you mentioned from the workforce. We have to make sure that we address all of those other issues and all those other aspects of this formal ecosystem. If not, you know, you're gonna have a break. And then it's not gonna work the way it needs to be. So that's the other point I really wanted to make and talk about, is like, what's next? Because we really need to address the entire system to really make sure that we sustain the progress that's been attained over the last 10 years.
Thank you, Lawrence. Great.
And let me just do a quick time check. I'm seeing a green light. What does that mean, Paul? We're at 20 minutes. Okay. So quickly, I want to invite any other panelist who really wants to speak to what's next. Like, what's top of mind for what's next? And I see it looks like maybe Penny, would you like to go? And then I'll ask Bruce as well.
Sure. in terms of future priorities, as I mentioned earlier, there's a large global donation program. It eventually will end. And while we have diseases that are targeted for elimination, and we hope the need for those drugs won't be there, there are other diseases that are not slated for elimination, but are undergoing, they're considered control diseases, where treatment will need to go on indefinitely. And the preparation, so preparing countries for that inevitability. You know, they're very supportive of having the NTD programs actively in place. We've built capacity on other levels, not just for drug, but for managing systems. USAID has a huge initiative now for self-reliance, helping countries to work towards graduating from USAID support. With that will be procuring and then distributing their own drugs. One of the challenges, so finding manufacturers and potential buyers for drugs, so that's a huge priority. One of the things we're hearing, though, from a handful of countries, and we anticipate it's going to get larger, is that they're saying, well, we'll come up with a budget, which is in itself is another big, big challenge. We'll come up with a budget, but we only want to buy from our own manufacturing base. So if country X has a very small and not very robust manufacturing base, but they are willing to buy these drugs from there, they're asking for our support to help them build that regulatory system base that Jude and Lawrence just mentioned, as well as manufacture the drugs. And so those are big asks. And they're asking to do it on an individual country by country level versus maybe buying one from a country in their region from whom they might buy it, who already has a robust system. So those are big challenges there that we're wrestling with, because we want them to sustain the gains they've made in the NTD program. So that's a big part of it. One thing I didn't mention earlier, but that was a surprise for us, was the applicability of the NTD drugs to other health sectors. We've been approached by other health sectors to say we're waiting for pre-qualified albendazole and ivermectin to come on the market because we really want to buy it for these other areas that are not related to NTDs, which was a huge surprise, but also a great long-term benefit, and there was clearly a chain reaction there. So while we want to support those efforts, you know, we always have to think too of how it benefits the NTD programs, but that's something that we hadn't anticipated, but there are potential avenues there too. So that's something we're looking at long term.
Thanks, Penny. And then maybe a very brief what's next from Deuce, and then we'll take questions from the audience.
Yeah, I think what is next, first of all, we have expressed it in our renewal of memorandum of understanding with USP, because in that we just said we want this cooperation because we have seen what it does and we would like it to continue. So that's what we have demonstrated. Having said that, we've had that we are talking about expand the scope of PQ. And that we are talking about NCDs, we are talking about anti-malarial, anti-cancers, we are talking about antimicrobial resistance. So we'll need partners to achieve that. But having said that, we also need to move the figure that I talked about, the only 26% of regulatory systems. We would like to expand, to strengthen the regulatory systems. And we need partners in that, not only training the regulators and working with the systems to make sure that they actually work. So we need partners in that, not only in strengthening regulators, but maybe actual specific training in a specific area. So
thank you, Deuce.
Not the time to let down.
Right. That's right. That's right. Yep. That is a key message. Okay, well, I think this panel has introduced the topic very effectively. I'd like to take some questions or comments from the audience. We have a catch box here. Ron, please. And maybe introduce yourself and your affiliation.
Yeah, I'm pleased to get us started. I'm very pleased and proud to be affiliated with USP as CEO from 5 years ago. So it's an affiliation that I talk about quite a bit, actually. It's a pleasure to be here. My question to any of you, I think Akabe is in an interesting position, is what do we see evidence? Is it true that a work to move towards an international standard not only can produce the quality medicines we're talking about, but can it be an economic driver? Someone mentioned exports earlier, I think maybe Lawrence did. And I mentioned it for the reason that has effect, of course, positive effects locally, and perhaps a finance minister might pay attention. But then, of course, that medicine is being exported somewhere, and someone else is getting a quality medicine. So you have a sense that there's an opportunity, but do we see it happening, or is it still a theory?
So maybe we could have Urban, would you take that question?
Yeah, thank you for the question. Actually, it's a very big investment in the compliance with the international standard, because we invest not only in the facility, but the biggest thing we invest in our people. So at the end, we have a very good positioning in our country because we already adopting the international standard. So at the end, it will also increase our sales in our country. So I think comply with the international standard, yes, it's have a good relationship with the economic situation with our company. Yeah.
Thank you. And then we'll go to the next question. There's the next question.
Shahid Raza. Basically, I'm here on the invitation of Mr. Khalid Bukhari, who works for USP. And what I wanted to ask you was that I work for a company in the UK, and I also work for a company in Pakistan. And the discrepancy which I see in quality in UK versus Pakistan is huge. So this program has done very well. So you have helped, I think, probably about 2% or 1% of the companies in Pakistan. But when we talk of quality, we want to, you know, ramp up the other companies which are not there yet. And now that this program is closing, is there a mechanism that this work can continue?
Thank you. Let me send that question over to Lawrence.
I would send that question over to USAID.
Fair enough.
Yeah, well, the USAID have seen the evidence and, you know, the success of the program, and it was obvious it was a great investment, I feel. But they've actually, they have the foresight, and they've actually put out a call, an APS, for a new program called PQM Plus, which is actually public information publicly available. So they are thinking about this and putting in things in place to continue work globally. And that's all I can actually really speak on at this time about
it. We would say that's procurement sensitive.
Okay, Ian.
Hi, Ian Worthen, Global Growth at USP. My question is kind of like a broader one. It's this existential number that I'm looking for. When Jude was presenting, he talked about infectious disease and that being the key driver for the need for quality medicines. A lot of what we talk about today within the AIDS community is non-communicable diseases, chronic diseases. If we just think of it from a volume perspective, is there any sense of how much of a multiple increase that is? Is it twice as many meds, four times, eight times?
So that's a good math question, or maybe a broader question on how we address access to quality shared medicines outside of the kind of key disease areas that we've been mentioning, outside of infectious disease and other areas. Do you want to speak to that briefly, Deuce?
Okay. First of all, to say that whatever we do, whatever support we give or we feed is catalytic. Because when you support such a manufacturer and gain standards, you will not only, those standards will not be only applied to levofloxacin, but all the products that. When you work with a professor here from Nigeria as a regulator of NAFDAC, and strengthen her regulatory systems in Nigeria, she's not only regulating HIV, but that actually goes into as a multiplier effect. So whatever we do will only be catalytic. But that's why I actually applaud the movement from not only just support, just strengthening systems, so that then they have. We should look at the programs that we have as only catalytic, and we've seen that one company that is not here told us it has one of the, I think, the longest products or list of products on the pre-qualification list. But they said their most sales actually are not only of the pre-qualified, but other products that are not pre-qualified because they have been identified as a capable manufacturer that can manufacture quality assured medicines. Having said that, we would then need, we know we are in the decade of NCDs. That's the UN focus. We'll need to look at that. There's a new focus on antimalarial resistance, antimicrobial resistance. And all these, not forgetting the neglected tropical diseases. So we will focus on these that are global programs, well knowing that focusing on these global programs has a multiplier effect on other areas.
Thank you.
Maybe I can, I want to add some comment for that, because in our side we are not only implement the system to one production area, since we have 46 lines in our side, but we not stop with that. We also share to our manufacturing facility, since we in Indonesia we have 12 manufacturing facility, and we also adopted the WHO standard into our corporate quality manual, and our corporate quality also conducting audit among site, so the system also implemented in other site. And not only that, this experience make us more confidence to going forward with the other international standard. Maybe I want to share with you, this year at the Cikarang facility, we already start our effort to getting US FDA certification. We will start our first mock-up audit next month on 25 and 26 July. And two other sites are ready for the EU certification. So maybe something that
Excellent.
I want to share.
It's very Thank compelling. You. Thank you. Do we, I think there's a yellow light, which probably means 5 minutes. Okay, so we have five more minutes. We'll take a couple more questions. We have other questions from the audience or comments. Okay, Professor Moji, please.
Hi, Yeah, the impact of PQM on trade is what I just want to make a brief comment on. The example of chlorhexidine is a good example. First, it's not just saving lives of children, but because of the ECOWAS agreement, you see a lot of those products in ECOWAS countries that are, you know, being exported there. So I take health and trade together when it comes to from the regulatory perspective, especially because if the quality is built into the system, you are strengthening the system, both regulatory or manufacturing, then it's going to translate into trade, it's going to translate into reducing unemployment in the country, it's going to translate into less violence or even terrorism, because when you have people that are jobless, you know, devil usually will find something for them to do. So it is it may look innocuous in terms of quality of medicine, but it translates, you know, it just multiplies country by country. Thank you.
All right, the multiplier effect. I like that. Other comments or questions? If not, I'll ask one. Okay. So maybe the final question. We haven't talked a lot about local pharmaceutical production. I think we've talked about it in some regards, and certainly WHO pre-qualification is important, but we can't pre-qualify every medicine on the market. So someone could speak to the role of localizing manufacturing production closer to the patient and building manufacturing capacity in country. So I would put that to either Lawrence or Deuce.
Okay, in fact, let me start with Professor Mogi's country. Again, it brings in two aspects. It's a country where we worked closely with PQM, first of all, but secondly, where we actually focused on local manufacturing. We got together with, first of all, you need a partnership and a working partnership. Not only, you know, people who talk to each other and can actually exchange and move things forward. And that environment was there in Nigeria. We had the ministry and government that was willing to support local production and had even preserved certain products for local manufacturing. We had NAFDAC that was committed, and we had manufacturing association that was willing to partner with us, and we had a partner, PQM, that was willing to work with the manufacturers. They themselves, without our involvement, the local partners, selected which companies should be supported and which products should be used as a catalyst to support that. And even when we came in as either on inspection, I remember I inspected four of the sites. I actually did not, all I did, I came as a lead inspector. I had two co-inspectors from NAFDAC, and they are the ones writing the reports I was only proofreading that. That was focusing on local product, and those people, those manufacturers were not only manufacturing the reproductive health or UN Commission life-saving commodities that we are looking at, but manufacturing products that are used in Nigeria over, and that is where and looking at Nigeria, a country of over 140 to 180, 200 million.
Only.
Definitely local manufacturing and quality local manufacturing makes sense. So definitely local manufacturing has a place, needs to be supported, and need all the systems, not only manufacturers, regulatory systems, quality control to support it, but government also to support. Yeah. I just want to end on that point, and I want to turn to USAID and governments. There's one thing saying that I support local production, I support. Then if somebody invests in quality manufacturing, The system should reward that so that people can see incentives in investing in quality. If you have a scenario when people invest, and because you now consider them to be either expensive and you actually stop buying from them, what message are you giving to people who would want to invest in increasing quality? I think that's the message I want to end on.
Perfect. I think we're out of time. Do you have an urgent remark, Lawrence? You want to close it? Final remark?
No, I'll let you close it.
But, too much pressure.
No, just the one point, though. I know Du says he wanted to end on that about the policies and that. Actually, I want to just add on to that, because I put these policies and things into a other category. Because I know in terms of PQM, we've worked with a lot of countries in terms of developing their policies related to pharmaceutical manufacturing, their regulations and things. But then at this other policies that are actually related to trade, it deals with tariffs. Those are things that we have to also look at that can actually hinder local manufacturing, because it actually, in some cases, if we don't address it, you have an uneven playing field, because you have, manufacturers in other countries where, costs can be somewhat low, but then after that, when you have policies that doesn't incentivize local manufacturing, then it's another hurdle for them. So that was the last point I just wanted to end on.
Well, huge thanks to everyone, our distinguished panelists and the audience for the great questions. I believe we'll go to break.
Yes. It's 10:55, please.
So please return at 10:55. And I believe there's an opportunity to look at some of the displays in our knowledge fair on the side and perhaps some refreshments in the plenary. And don't forget your reflection cards. Please write down any reflections to date. And don't forget to tweet.
And if you have more information about PQM's work about in local manufacturing, and not just local manufacturing, but manufacturing over there, our senior manager, Nikhil, he actually can talk to you more about some of the success and achievements that the PQM program has actually attained over the last 10 years.